For all of us who have been in the startup ecosystem, in entrepreneurship in some way or the other over the years, we all know you. One of the things I think many here in the room will vouch for, besides you being the big man in Google, is that anyone who's doing a startup wanted you as an angel investor. So we followed you over the years, and it's good to have you today with us. My first question to you would be, you know, you've been in Google for so many years, seen a different kind of culture and process, and now you are in Sequoia, in a venture capital fund, and now you're also looking at Surge, which is an early stage program. What are the similarities? What is the difference? And if I may take the liberty to ask you, why the decision?
Yeah, no, first of all, it's great to be here, great to see all of you here, and congratulations on 10th year of TechSparks. I think you've been such an integral part of the entire Indian startup ecosystem. So it's honored to be here. So maybe I'll start with like why the switch, because I get that question asked often. Look, I've been a very active angel investor for a very long period of time, and I knew that at some point I would want to actually become a full-time investor, and I didn't know what that time would be. Shailendra Singh, who you know well, at Sequoia, Shailendra started talking to me about Surge about a year ago, and you know, the more he talked to me about it, the more excited I got. And Sequoia as a firm, you know, is a very mission-driven sort of firm. And you know, I could relate to that. So really, it was, you know, I knew this was something I'd wanted to do at some point. You know, it was an opportunity that seemed very, very exciting. Now I've been there 2 months. So it is very, very exciting. And I think more, in addition to that, you know, anything that you do, you know, timing's really important. And I felt that feel very strongly that the time for India's startup ecosystem is now, right? And we can talk more about that. But what we are seeing in India today, we haven't seen ever in India for sure. And I think, with maybe exception of the U.S., we haven't seen anywhere else in the world. And you know, anything that I do, I try to sort of take a 10 to 20 year view of what I'm going to do. And personally, and I said, look, if you're going to bet on something, this is sort of the bet to make right now. So I'm very excited to do that. I think, look, in terms of how it's similar, they're both very mission-driven companies, right? Sequoia's mission is, you know, help the daring build legendary companies, and really mean that. You know, those are all very important words, sort of daring, legendary, you know, help the daring build legendary companies. And you know, I was very inspired by that, and now that I've been there for 2 months, it's been very similar, and also very, very focused. Google's a very, very focused company. You know, Sequoia obviously is a very, very focused firm in a different field. So, long answer to your question, but
good. You know, so in fact, what you were saying is that it's a great time to be in India. I'll quote something that you said. There was a time when it was difficult to raise even $10 million for Indian entrepreneurs. But today in India, you can raise $1 billion. We are very much on track to have 100 unicorns by 2025. This is a very interesting phase for the Indian startup ecosystem. And Rajan, I would like to understand from you, because you've been in this space and you've seen it over the years, over the last few years, is that while we are saying at one point, Junat, in one way that, hey, it's a great time to be an entrepreneur and do startup in India. But then there's this larger narrative that, oh, India has still not produced such great outcomes. So tell me, why are you bullish and what are some of the signals you are seeing?
Yeah, by the way, by the time India starts producing a large number of outcomes, it's going to be too late. You know, that's what people kind of don't realize, right? So that's why timing is sort of really, really important. Look, I think we've entered a new phase of India's startup ecosystem. So I'm calling it, you know, sort of Indian startup ecosystem 2.0, but the internet startup ecosystem. I mean, India is sort of thousands of years of entrepreneurship, right? So in many ways, you know, a nation of entrepreneurs and startups. But when it comes to the sort of this era of startups, we've clearly entered this new, let's just call it the 2.0 phase, right? And it's characterized by a few things. The first is, you know, when I joined Google in 2011, there were 10 million active Android users. Okay, today there are 400 million plus. So 10 million to 400 million. Now, when you have 400 million active Android users, that starts impacting everything, right? So if you had asked me a year ago, will you see a company like Katabook without any feet on the street with 15 engineers that could get 5 million Kirana shops to use a digital product? I would have said absolutely not, because it could have taken like thousands of salespeople, right? You'd have to have thousands of sales. What happened there? What happened there was geo happened. You know, all these merchants started buying Android phones. They all started getting connected. And when you actually build a product that works for them, they get on it and then they start using it. You have 3.5 million active merchants, right? So the first thing that has really happened is the user base has gotten very large. And it's started permeating all parts of society, right? It's not just the first 100 million users who are using the internet for what they're doing. So that's the first thing. And that's really, this is very profound. I think Katabook, what I've seen with Katabook is something I would have not predicted in a million years a year ago, right? I mean, think about it, 3.5 million. So that's the first thing. I think second, look, we're seeing the startup ecosystem broad base. Right, it used to be, it was consumer internet, it was e-commerce, a little bit of ride hailing, and you know, just a little bit of everything else. Right, today actually that's part of it. I mean, just in e-commerce, right? If you had asked me 3 years ago, will we see a new generation of e-commerce companies come and take the market by storm? You know, you look at Flipkart and Amazon and some of the other players like Snapdeal, and you say, look, this game is sort of done. Meesho comes out of nowhere. Bulbul comes out of nowhere. SimSim comes out of nowhere, right? Social commerce. It's the next big thing, right? So even in traditional spaces like e-commerce, you look at, you know, transport, right? You look at companies like Bounce and Rapido and so on. And then you've got this whole new wave or whole new set of sectors, direct-to-consumer brands, right? I really do believe that we are now in an era over the next 10 years. We're going to see many billion-dollar new consumer brands that are going to get built because they're going to start with digital and then they're going to kind of expand into, you know, offline retail over some period of time, right? You look at SaaS. You know, today we have 3 SaaS unicorns. Nobody remembers this. Actually, 18 months ago, we had 0, right? Freshwork was the first, Druva, then Icertis. And now we're at a clip of probably 1 or 2 SaaS unicorns a year. And then in 3 or 4 years, we'll get to 3 or 4 SaaS unicorns a year, right? You look at spaces like fintech. You know, there are $30 billion NBFCs in India, publicly traded. Okay, I mean, 30 was before the market corrected. Maybe that's 20. I don't know what the number is. But is there a reason why, you know, Vijay was here? Vijay is going to be just gigantic company, $50, $100 billion, right? But can we see 20, $30 billion fintech companies in India? The answer is absolutely yes. So broad basing is also very, very important. And I think the third thing that's really, really profound is we're seeing founders who have a lot more experience. Naveen, who just spoke, said 60 Inmobiites have started companies. There are over 100, several hundred founders who actually came out of Flipkart. You look at Paytm, you look at Oyo, you look at Google, you look at Uber, right? And that's very profound because when somebody is actually seen, when a founder who's, let's say, you know, spent 3 years, 5 years, 7 years at one of these unicorns and they've lived through this journey of hyperscale, of blitzscaling, they just know a lot more, right? And as a result, they're able to build these. And so if you look at these and add on top of this the fact that going global as a consumer internet company is sort of okay now. Right? Paytm's done it, Oyo's done it, Ola's doing it. So the idea of, you know, if you're a consumer internet company, you have to only be in India, is sort of an old idea, right? The new idea is you go global. Yeah. And some of us search companies are going global from day zero, consumer internet, not B2B, right? So when you look at all of these things, you know, we've clearly entered a new era. And this era is just going to be bigger, it's going to be broader, it's going to be faster. And you know, I think this 100 unicorns by 2025, which we started talking about sort of late last year, is going to happen.
Wow. You know, you are talking so convincingly that I'm convinced. And this is amazing. But one of the things that you said, and I want to bring this out for the benefit of all the entrepreneurs here, is I see too many Indian founders going after small problems. Don't go after small problems, go after large problems. I want you know, Rajan, tell us about this, and also from your lens as an investor, because you've invested in a lot of companies. You've seen companies succeed, and you've seen many companies not succeed. And it would be, you know, the examples you gave were of successful companies, you know, the ones, the outliers, if I may say so. How can we have more of those companies?
Yeah, so I think this is a very important point, right? Is, look, the reality is if you're an entrepreneur, you're just starting up, you're going to spend the next, you know, 8, 10, 15, 20 years, right? Yeah. Vijay started 21 years ago. You know, you started, you know, over a decade ago, right? So if you're going to spend 10, 15, 20 years of the most productive years of your life building something, and all of you know this, right? Almost all of you in this room are entrepreneurs. If you're an entrepreneur, you're working, you know, 17, 18 hours a day, you're working 7 days a week. I mean, that's a long time to spend, right? And if you're going to work that hard, you should really build a big business, right? If you're going to work that hard, you should build a big business. And if you want to build a big business, you have to start off at least focusing on a space that's broad enough to lend itself to a big business, right? If you spend a couple of days thinking about it and you say, look, at best, I'm going to build a 50 crore company, revenue, okay? It's not big enough because it might take you, you know, 5 years, it might take you 10 or 15 years to get to 50 crores or 100 crores. And by the time you get there, you know, you could have done something else to get there, right? So I think this idea of focusing on spaces or segments that are big enough where you can build a large business, I think is very, very important, right? And by the way, I mean, you know, from, you know, as an angel investor, you know, I had to see a minimum of what I called an IndieCon, right? An IndieCon is 1,000 crores. So if I could see a company getting to an IndieCon, which is 1,000 crores, you know, I'm with you, right? But as an institutional investor, you know, that's just not there. You have to get more like 7,000 crores or 10,000 crores. And if you're focusing on a small market or let's say a small, you know, space, it's hard to see how you're going to build a very big business. The other thing that's important about a space is why is now the time? Yeah. It's a very important question, right? Khatam Book wouldn't have been built as we speak if Jio hadn't happened, if Airtel hasn't dropped prices, if 400, 500 million Indians weren't using smartphones, because the Kirana shop owners wouldn't actually have smartphones, right? Yeah. So big space and why is the time now? I mean, these questions become very important.
Yeah. Jio, tell us about Surge. Surge is the new buzzword in the town, you've been in the space, but Surge has come and has created so much of noise. And if I may say so, some of the investors who are not part of Sequoia also have this FOMO syndrome that you guys are getting to see very good early stage companies. Tell us what's happening there.
Yeah, look, I think Surge was launched 8 months ago. Surge is Sequoia's rapid scale-up program focused on early stage startups in India and Southeast Asia, you know, with the intent of giving them an unfair competitive advantage, right? So the reason Sequoia India actually launched Surge was because of a couple of observations that the team has had, right? So Shailendra and the other partners have had over many years. The first was, you know, as an early stage founder, as a seed stage founder, it's very, very difficult to raise the kind of funding that you need before you can get to Series A, right? Normally, you need to raise two or three rounds of funding. Your feeds, you know, your seed round is a couple of crores. You almost always need to raise another round and so on and so forth, right? And as a result, founders, early stage founders, end up spending an enormous amount of time fundraising as opposed to building the product, as opposed to hiring team, as opposed to getting going. So that's the first thing. Second thing was an observation that, you know, building a successful company, an enduring company, right, is a lot more than just product market fit. Product market fit is the most important thing, but it's a lot more than that, right? Is, do you have a mission that you really relate to? Do you have a company values? Do you hire the right people, right? Do you think about your business model and your moats in right ways? And very little attention was paid to any of those things in the first few years of your journey. Is there a way to make sure that early stage founders are able to learn those things and develop that sort of those set of things very early, right? So that was very important. I think the third thing was, look, you know, it was pretty clear that getting the right investors on your cap table was very, very important, right? And not just one or two firms, but, you know, can you get the right set of investors to the, and fourth one was hiring, right? Especially technical talent. You know, if you're a new startup, hiring great engineers, hiring a head of sales, hiring a head of marketing is very tough. So all of these challenges we took and said, look, can Sequoia come up with a program that tries to address each of these challenges in a systematic way, right? So if you're a search company, you get $1 to $2 million upfront. That way, a founding team can spend the time building their product, hiring the first set of people, landing their first customer, and not worry about fundraising for 6, 12, 18 months. So that's the first thing. Second, you know, huge amount of focus on the holistic aspects of company building, right? How do you really have a mission that you relate to, that your whole company relates to, right? How do you actually think about values from day zero so that you don't end up as a company that really is the kind of company you shouldn't be, right? Because a lot of companies just kind of grow into something that they don't want to. How do you think about business models and moats in a very, very deep way? So holistic aspects of company building. The third one really is global expansion, right? Global immersion. We have, you know, our program is structured. It's Singapore, Bangalore, Beijing, Silicon Valley, back to Singapore. Over 16 weeks, it's 5 weeks, five full-time weeks, but you know, 1 week a month sort of thing, right? And what we wanted to do was really bring the best the world has to offer. If you want to figure out how to blitz scale and deal with hyper competition, you know, China is probably the place to go learn it from, right? So we have a whole week in China where the founders really learn about how to do that, you know, as they grow up. And then lastly is really open architecture. It's a very, very important part of the surge design choice that we've made. 80% of the companies in the second cohort, Shradha, are basically have co-investors, right? So to your point of, you know, we want to make this a very, very collaborative, open architecture type model, right? Where we want other co-investors to invest with us in the surge round, and then obviously in the following round as well. And then the last thing is, the way surge is set up is, you know, at the end of 5 months, for the companies that are ready to raise their follow-on rounds, we set up something called Upsurge Week, right? Where we get the best investors from around the world to come and spend a week, and all our startups get to spend time one-on-one. So it's not a 20-minute pitch or a 5-minute pitch or a 10-minute pitch, but really it's sort of meet one-on-one with as many investors who have an interest in you, you have an interest with, so that we can sort of, again, make that whole process better. The last thing I'd say is, look, we're a startup too, all right? We started sort of 8 months ago, and we're incredibly humbled by the response that we've got, and, you know, we will continue to evolve what we're doing as well.
Thanks, Rajan. I was telling this to Shailendra also, to the point of Sequoia being a startup. It's what a startup, and with what incredible resources. And I think entrepreneurs who are getting into search program are lucky, because they get such a huge access to all of you and to what Sequoia brings. Having said that, the question I have is, you know, on the selection, because these kind of programs can select only 18, 20, 15, 10 people. And what would you say to the companies that are not getting selected? What are some of the criterias? How can company become a part of this?
Yeah, no, club? Absolutely. So first thing to keep in mind is, you know, it's never too early to apply to search. It's never too early to apply to Sequoia or reach out to Sequoia, right? I think it's a very important point, because a lot of people think that they need to have a lot of traction. So we will have 15 to 20 companies in a cohort, right? Actually, in fact, a couple of days ago, we announced that you can apply to surge anytime, right? So we will have two cohorts. One will start in March. The other one will start in September. So we started our second cohort of surge ever 3 weeks ago. But you can apply anytime. And then we will review the application. And then, you know, if we think that this makes sense, we'll go ahead. In fact, we've already selected three companies for Surge 3, which will actually start in March 2020. So if you think about this as stage and sector, right? 6 out of the 20 companies in Surge 2 are pre-launch when we actually selected them. In fact, 4 out of the 6 are still pre-launch, right? So, you know, stage doesn't really matter. I mean, obviously, we'd like you to be earlier the better, yeah. Right? So that's one. Second, you know, we have 10 B2B companies in Surge 2, right? Which is sort of a bit counterintuitive. In fact, we have companies like Log9, which is a nanotech-based energy storage company, right? We have a robotics, sort of human layer on top of a robotics company. So we have a lot of B2B companies as well. So you can be B2C, you can be B2B. We had 3 direct-to-consumer brands in Surge 1. We have 2 direct-to-consumer brands in Surge 2. So stage, not really relevant. Never too early to apply to Surge. Sector you're in, not really relevant, although we'd like you to have some tech element to it, right? If you're building a dental clinic by itself, that's probably not something you wanna apply to Surge 2. Now, in terms of what we look for, really, it's 2 things, right? If you're a pre-launch company, we're looking at the quality of the team, right? This is a founding team that is very deep inside into the problem they're solving. Do they seem like they would have the resilience to go after it, build for 10 to 15 years? You know, things like that. Can they actually attract and build a team? So on and so forth. And then second, we're looking at the space. It goes back to, you know, are you focusing on a space that's large enough where you will be able to build a very large and impactful company over a period of time? So we spend a lot of time looking at the space. So I would say those are the 2 most important things we look at. If you've already launched, which is, you know, 14 out of the 16 companies that you've launched, we do look at the early metrics. And the reason we're looking at the early metrics is it gives us a sense of, you know, how's this product really beginning to take off, right? And a lot of these companies have not found product market fit. So we are not looking for sort of that kind of product market fit curve, but we're looking at some early metrics to say, so today, my view is if there are 400 million Android users in India, if you've already launched and you're building a consumer internet product, let's say an app, and you can't get to, you know, some minimum double-digit thousands of daily active users, you know, it may not be that, you know, the team may not really be thinking deeply about a product, right? So I'd say that's the sort of the third thing we look at. We look at the metrics, but only if the company is launched.
Rajan, you know, I have one question for everyone who's like looking at raising money or, you know, meeting investors. You've met so many entrepreneurs and you've invested besides, you know, now your role in Surge and in with Sequoia. I've known you like for so many years, you know, you keep on hearing Rajan Anandan is an investor in this company and that. What are some of the things that gets you excited to invest in a company and what are some of the things that you would tell entrepreneurs to be mindful of?
Yeah, I think, look, at the end of the day, the earlier you go, right, the bigger the bet is on the founding team. So make sure that, you know, you're doing it for the right reason. Make sure you're very, very deep into the problem, right? Because, you know, it's very easy for, not easy, but, you know, very quickly you can tell whether a founding team has very deep insight into the problem that you're solving. That's why, you know, you'll see some of the most successful founders, they're solving a problem that they face themselves, right? Yeah. Because of that, you're kind of deep, right? So I'd say that's what it is. Second, look, be passionate, you know, about what you're building, right? Because that comes through. And I'd say the third one, which is very interesting, you know, spending time with Shailendra, Mohit, and GV, Shailesh, etc. One of the things I've learned is, you know, be very authentic. You know, say it like it is, right? Look, if you haven't automated yet, and you've got a warehouse full of 100 people that are packing and shipping, just say it like it is. Because the minute you try to sugarcoat it, boom, your investors will see through it, right? So be authentic. Be, you know, describe the longer term vision that you want to get to. But at the same time, you know, just say it like it is. Because if you don't say it like it is, it'll come up. And you know, this is actually one of the most interesting things I've noticed in the last 2 months is not enough entrepreneurs are authentic about themselves, about what they're trying to do, and also about the reality of where things are. Look, startups are imperfect. Yeah. It is okay not to be okay. In fact, it's one of the Surge ethoses that we have. It's okay not to be okay, but it's not okay not to say it the way it is.
Thank you so much. Thanks a lot. Last, before we leave, your learning. You have been a very successful professional. Now you are a hotshot investor in Surge, which is making such great noise for all good reasons. If we have to ask you, your career trajectory has been phenomenal. What do you think have you done right, and what are some of the things that we could learn from you as a professional?
Yeah, look, first of all, there's nothing you can learn from me, right?
Oh, come on, Rajan.
No, I mean that, right? So, look, I've only had one principle to doing what I do, right? I tend to focus on things I'm really, really passionate about, and I give it everything I've got for as long as I continue to be passionate about it, right? So, for 10 or 15 years, I've been investing as an angel in startups, right? And I just love spending time with startups. You know, and I knew that at some point, you know, I wanted to see if I can actually be a full-time investor, right? I was at McKinsey for 11 years. I loved consulting. But at some point, you know, it got to a point where I said, look, I think I should try to see if I can go be an operator. So then I went to Dell, worked for Michael, did that, Microsoft, Google, etc. I was running, you know, very large businesses for a long period of time. So I just operate with this one principle, right? Pick things you're deeply passionate about and just give it all you've got. But at some point, you know, you don't have it. You know, and I ask this question, right? I tell all my teams, which is when you're coming to work in the morning, right? Either you're driving to work, you're taking the subway, you're taking a Rapido, or whatever, a bounce. You ask yourself this one question. Am I excited to be going to work today? Or am I excited to be going to my company today? If the answer to that is yes, and by the way, I ask myself this question every day, for many, many years, right? If the answer to that question is absolutely, this is the thing. If the answer to that several days in a row is, nah, I don't know, right? Then maybe it's not.
Yeah. Thank you so much. Thanks a lot.